honorees, if I could have your attention for just 1 minute. Chief Justice Melton and Justice Benham are here. You've seen Chief Justice Melton. They're coming down. They'll be with us in a few minutes, and then we'll get started. Before our honorees, I will be saying a few remarks before your videos. We'll have you come up with the steps. Usually, Chief Justice Melton will help with that. And I will hand you your award. Talking to this microphone. We're going to have them wiped down after each talk. Again, I'm just trying to be very cautious because I don't know what experiences people have had with COVID, and I want to be sensitive to the fact that some people have been devastated by this illness. So, talking to this microphone, and then my assistant Nicholas Stan, is going to help you downstage if you need it. You may want to hand your award to him, use the handrails to walk downstage, then he will give you your award back. And don't forget, after the program. And Dan, let me know when we are ready to start going live, and we will get started. The ladies understand. Okay. All right. There we go. Okay. And are we ready? Okay. Good evening. Good evening. My name is Carlise Greer. I am the Executive Director for the Chief Justice's Commission on Professionalism, and it is my great honor to welcome you all here tonight. Sort of the first welcome, the official one will come from the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of Georgia, Harold Melton. But to bring you greetings, to call us to order, to have the program to begin. And at this time, it is my great honor to introduce the chair of the Chief Justice's Commission on Professionalism, Harold D. Melton. And Justice Melton was sworn in on July 1st, 2005. As many of you know, he is getting ready to celebrate a new season and his retirement from the court effective June 30th, 2021. I am very grateful, however, that he, as one of his last official duties, is with us this evening to help present the Justice Robert Benham Awards for Community Service. As all of our honorees know, this award ceremony was originally scheduled for March 14th of 2020. And about 3 days before the award ceremony, the World Health Organization declared the novel coronavirus, novel at that time, we've been living with it for over a year now, COVID-19, a pandemic, a worldwide pandemic. And as a result, we decided for the safety of everyone to postpone the award ceremony. I'm very happy to say now, though, that with the advent of a vaccine and with the COVID-19 numbers going down, you were each able to gather with your families, each family in a separate room for dinner, and now here with us in socially distanced, theater-style seating with mask on. We're doing our very best to keep everyone safe for the Commission's first in-person event in over well over a year. And in addition, this is our very first live stream so that you could include your family and friends and colleagues who could not join us in person this evening. And so with that, I want to welcome the chair of our commission, my boss, someone that I greatly respect, Chief Justice Harold Melton, to the stage to bring you formal welcome and greetings.
Well, good evening, everybody. Congratulations to our honorees, and a special thanks to Carlise Greer, who is our executive director of the Commission on Professionalism, who has taken professionalism in the commission to newer heights throughout this last year. You heard about the challenges that she has had to overcome in order to get this event up and rolling. I won't go over that again, but I do want to thank her and her team and the commission and everybody that worked on getting this event up and running. We have a terrific group of honorees this year. In addition to the distinguished legal careers here, there's a sampling of some of the community service in which they have engaged. I'll just go through some of the things that you will hear about tonight. Some of our award winners have been involved in leading the commissioning of murals to beautify and develop the downtown Brunswick community. They've been involved in raising funds and food to combat food insecurity in Macon and throughout Middle Georgia. They've been involved in founding and growing UNICEF Next Generation Atlanta, a group of young professionals who support the work to help children in over 190 countries. They've been involved in launching the New Beginnings Reentry Program to give ex-offenders options and opportunities to get assistance as they re-enter society after incarceration. They've been involved in championing the workplace success for people with disabilities. They've been involved in teaching boxing to young people who need the help to learn discipline and respect. They are serving in numerous boards and establishing endowed scholarships for two schools. They are involved in founding a nonprofit organization that creates healthier outcomes for vulnerable children and families through programs that assist parents, grandparents, and their caregivers. You'll learn more about each of our honorees later. This is just a small sample of what they have each accomplished, because in addition, they have shared with you their lives and they shared their energies throughout their communities. And all of our honorees serve their communities in many additional ways. Our honorees set a standard for all lawyers throughout the state, and not just lawyers, but for judges as well. They demonstrate to everyone, lawyers and non-lawyers alike, that lawyers and judges are not just advocates in the courtrooms and negotiators in the boardrooms. Lawyers and judges are also impassioned workers and leaders in communities across Georgia, striving to make life better for everyone in our state in any number of ways. Let's give them all a hand of applause. I will also like to acknowledge that I believe we have one of our past recipients of the Justice Benham Awards. I do believe we have Judge Bill Adams here. If he's here, I want to acknowledge him. Thank you, Judge Adams. Judge Adams also is a sponsor for one of our honorees, so we're glad you're here, and thank you for your continued involvement. I do want to thank our sponsors. These are the people who have gone above and beyond, recognizing the importance of what this night means, and they have made contributions to make this night possible. At the gold level, I want to recognize Greenberg Troward. At the silver level, I want to recognize and thank Jones Day, Kilpatrick Townsend, King and Spaulding, Miller and Martin, Squire Patton Boggs. Also want to thank Troutman Pepper full name, which is Troutman Pepper Hamilton Sanders, formerly known as Troutman Sanders. At the bronze level, I want to thank Crevalon Horse. And then at the friend level, Brian Cave. And also give great thanks to the Georgia Defense Lawyers Association. At the supporter level, we have the Georgia Association of Black Women Attorneys and Ann Baird Bishop. Please give a round of applause for all of our sponsors. Again, I want to thank you for your presence here in support of our honorees, in support of Justice Benham and his wife, Ms. Nell Benham, and I hope you enjoy the rest of our evening.
Thank you, Justice Melton. Usually, this is the 21st annual Justice Robert Benham Awards for Community Service, and usually we have serving as a master of ceremony, Mr. Bill List with WXIA-TV, but he is at a family reunion, and I'm sure everyone understands and appreciates after so many months that many of us have spent away from our families, what it meant to him to be able to participate in that, and so he is not with us tonight. However, due to his generosity, the generosity of WXIA-TV and Steve Bossi, a videographer with the station, we have a video and a conversation with Bill List and Justice Benham. They would normally do it here in person, but they did it ahead of time for us, and so without further ado, I'm going to show that video now, and I do want to welcome Justice Robert Benham and his lovely wife, Ms. Nell Benham, who are with us here this evening.
And with that, I think probably, Justice Benham, one of the most important things is defining community service. Just how do you define it? You're one of the patrons of community service. How would you define it?
It's a difficult subject to define. I have to define it from the context of a lawyer. Lawyers are in the business of building up their community. Community service is just one aspect of the building up your community. So when I look at lawyers and tell lawyers that they need to be involved in community service, they need to be involved in building up their community. And that's what I see it as doing. Although there are difficulties along the way because we are dealing in an adversarial system that produces winners and losers. I think community service is an opportunity to sometimes to have a draw.
What got you really committed to community service yourself, and what led you then to feel the importance of suggesting an award to let people throughout the state, lawyers everywhere in the state, know how important this is?
Let me sort of start a little from the beginning as to how I got involved in community service. One is that people would ask me, why did you choose to practice law in Cartersville, Georgia? And I would tell them that was the last place I expected to be practicing law. But what happened, 50 years ago, being from Cartersville, my local judge, who was just J.L. Davis, a name that's synonymous with the Confederacy, asked me to come to see him. And because he and his son and I went to law school together, and he said, Bob says, what are you going to do when you finish law school? I said, I'm thinking about going to California to practice law. And he looked me right in the face and he says, who the hell do you know in California? And it hurt my feelings. It really hurt my feelings. He says, you are from Cartersville and you need to come back home to practice law. And he says, I know why you don't want to come back home, because this is the South. There are a lot of racial issues involved. But if you are unwilling to serve your own community, what makes you think that you can serve some other community? And he said, now I promise you this. I can't promise you that everything will go your way. I can't promise you that everything will be fair. but I will promise you that I will be fair. And that's the most I can promise any lawyer. And he kept his word over the years. Sometimes when he would appoint me to a death penalty case, I would go see him, and he would refuse to see me. he would refuse to see me. He told his secretary, tell Bob, he needs to go to jail and see his client. He doesn't need to be coming here to see me. And he and I talked about that later on, and he said, Bob, as a lawyer, your job is to do the best that you can do for a client. And the reason I appointed you to represent these death penalty claims, I knew that you would save their life. And that's one of the most important things that you can do as a lawyer. But now, you don't have to like the people you represent, but you have to like the system that you serve.
And at the same time, though, you became very committed to community service.
I did.
And what led you to establish the Community Service Award, which was a totally new concept at the time that you came up with it?
Well, what happened at that time, I also served on the board of directors of the Bartow County Training Center. And that was a center to serve children who were EMR and TMR. Now, they don't use these terms anymore today, because EMR meant educatable, mentally retarded, and TMR meant trainable, mentally retarded. These were kids that had severe handicaps. But the thing that sort of pushed me toward community service is that one day I was in the middle of a trial, and I got a call from the Bartow Training Center. And the director said, Colonel, that's what they call you nowadays, Colonel, we have a child here, and during his entire life, he's never been able to feed himself. But today, he picked up a spoon, and he's sitting here holding that spoon with food in it, and we believe that he's gonna try to feed himself. And you are chairman of the board, you need to be here to see it. I said, I'm in the middle of a trial. He said, well, try to come. And I went to Judge J.L. Davis, who's the judge there, and I said, Judge, they called me from the training center, and this child is about to feed himself, and they want me to come. And I understand that I'm in the middle of a trial. This is what he said, Bob, forget about this trial. That child may never feed himself again. You need to be there to see that happen. And so he suspended the trial and everything. I went there and stood there, and that child put the food to his mouth. Because I knew the child and knew the child's family and everything, and I said, this is what serving your community is all about. And so I got involved with that group and then got involved with other groups. And it has been fulfilling over the years, I think. And I've encouraged lawyers over a period of time to get involved with their community.
Because, well, you've been very, very successful in doing that, that's for sure. And let me ask you this, Judge. Does lawyer professionalism and commitment to the profession require community service? Do you feel that that's a necessary and absolute component, even though when you take the oath and you do various things, community service is not listed amongst them, but do you feel that's a requirement?
I feel that it is extremely beneficial to the lawyer and to the community. I understand that a lot of lawyers disagree with me on that, but I think the law itself provides a service to the community, and I think community service is a part of that. Now, I know in some jurisdictions, lawyers just don't do it. They don't feel that that's what they should do. But it made the practice of law and the administration of justice much more beneficial to me for having been involved in the community service aspect. And I have not talked to one lawyer who regrets ever being involved in community service.
Do you feel that it's expanding now? I mean, there are so many things going on now in our society that are so troubling, right across the board. And do you feel that more and more lawyers now are feeling that responsibility, not just necessarily fulfilling an obligation of their law firm that they should do this or that, But do you feel that it's really expanding voluntarily, that lawyers are really saying, hey, wait a minute, I've really got to give back my community?
I think so. You know, just from the lawyers that I know, I have not talked to one lawyer who's been involved with community service who felt that it was not rewarding, not just for the profession, but for them personally, because some of the things that they do, they never would have been exposed to but for that community service aspect. But, and I realize that some lawyers say that they are social workers and they don't want to be involved in things like that. I respect them for that. I don't embrace that approach because it's all part of serving your community. You know, had I not been involved in community service, I don't think the law would have been as enriching as it was for me.
Do you feel the community service awards are still as relevant now as they were when you first established them so many years ago?
Yes, I do. I know there are people, mentioned when I talked about community service, as well, there Bob is with all this do-gooder stuff. If it's do-gooding to restore, revive, and improve your community, I plead guilty to that. And I don't regret my efforts on the part of community service. I think it's made me a better lawyer, a better judge, and a better family person.
Now that you've retired from the bench, are you still active in community service?
I do. I've served on boards over a number of years. I'm not as directly involved as I was at one time. I'm throttling back, and for good reason. I'm from what my wife refers to as a bygone era, and some of my beliefs are not that acceptable in present day time. I understand that. But I think the community service aspect gives you an opportunity to do things in the community that don't have that much to do with the law. But I think that they improve the law because they sensitize people to the needs of others in the community. I don't ever regret having initiated this community service endeavor, and any chance I get to speak for it, I will do that because I think it's made me a better person. It's made the law a better profession, and it's helped to improve the community.
If you had a bit of advice that you wanted to give to young lawyers who are just entering the profession, where community service, oh yeah, when I have time, maybe I'll get involved in something like that, what would be the best advice and counsel you could give to the generations who are now coming into the practice of law in Georgia?
The advice I would like to give them is that the law is one of many tools that you use to improve the community. But the community service aspect of the practice of law gives you a chance to use the law to improve the community, because all legal issues have some beginning in community difficulty that arose. And when you look at the community service aspect of it, you can say, okay, this isn't mentioned in the statutes, it isn't mentioned in the Constitution, but it is a part of what makes this community whole. And if you can make the community whole, then you've really done a wonderful job as a lawyer. And I've seen more and more lawyers who will come to me and say, well, I'm glad I was involved in this. I was involved in drug courts. I was involved in mental health courts. I was involved in poverty litigation and things like that. And it made them a better person. And I haven't talked to any lawyer yet, and I doubt if he'd come say anything to me who said, I sure regret having been involved in community service. But it is something that is now prevalent throughout the country. And I think lawyers feel better about themselves, and the community feels better about lawyers, because at the base of the practice of law, it is an adversarial system. And sometimes the adversarial system, while solving the problem, will not heal the community. But when you look at it from the community service aspect, you have a better chance of solving the problem and healing the community at the same time.
Thank you, Justice Benham, for sharing those words of wisdom with us. I do have a small token from the commission for you here. Last year when we were planning this celebration, it was also to highlight and honor you for 30 years of service on the Supreme Court of Georgia and your retirement at that time. And so I hope you've enjoyed your first year of retirement. I thank you for being with us this evening, and I would invite you and Chief Justice Melton to join me now on stage so that we can recognize our wonderful group of honorees this year. Thank you, gentlemen. First, we have Miss Rita Spaulding. And as you came in, you probably saw many of the poster boards lining the halls out there, and I want to thank Rita for bringing those. One of the things that Rita does, and that you'll hear more about in the tribute video that we're about to play shortly, was help to commission murals in her hometown of Brunswick to help develop the community. And so let's look at her video, learn a little bit more about what Rita does, and I invite you to look at each of the poster boards that are outside after this evening.
Rita C. Spaulding is a double dog, having received both her Bachelor's of Political Science and her Juris Doctorate degree from the University of Georgia. She has managed her own law firm since 2008, concentrating in mediation and in the preparation and negotiation of leases and contracts, and in representing the Coastal Georgia Area Community Action Authority Incorporated, a private nonprofit corporation. She also serves as a part-time deputy magistrate judge in the Glenn County Magistrate Court. Spaulding serves on the steering committee of Forward Brunswick, an organization that supports the economic and community development of downtown Brunswick, Georgia. She also assists with Rise Risley LLC, a project to revitalize a historic African-American school in downtown Brunswick. Spaulding is a key member of the Brunswick Downtown Development Authority and a leader in the Downtown Brunswick Mural Project. She led the effort by commissioning a giant painting of Lady Justice on the exterior wall of her downtown law firm, and has helped other leaders team up with artists to enhance the look of the downtown area. She is a lay Eucharistic minister and volunteers at the Safe Harbors Children's Center, a local safe haven for children who have nowhere else to turn. Spaulding has devoted her life to community service in the coastal Georgia area. And as her nominator says, if all of us followed her example of community service, there would be no lawyer jokes. Ladies and gentlemen, we salute Rita C. Spaulding.
Congratulations. And Rudy, if you'll step to the mic and just make your brief remarks for us.
Good evening, and thank you so much for this award. I want to thank the Honorable Lisa Godby Wood, who nominated me. I want to thank my client representatives who are here tonight with me. Thank you for allowing me to serve. I want to thank my family, my kids, for learning how to take care of themselves well so I could keep working, learning how to do laundry and cook. And most of all, I want to thank my husband, who takes a real interest in everything that I do and supports me in so many ways. Thank you all.
Thank you, Rita. Our next honoree is from Judicial District 2, Judge Connie Williford. And in the video, you will hear her referred to as an attorney because we created all of these videos over a year ago. And since that time, Judge Williford is now a judge of the Superior Court of Macon. And in learning more about her and putting together the bio, I learned a lot about food insecurity in Middle Georgia and all of the wonderful work that Judge Williford has done to address that, as well as providing pro bono service to victims of domestic violence and so many other things. And so let's take a moment to look at the video for Judge Williford.
Connie L. Williford graduated from Mercer Law School in 2000 and has practiced law in Macon ever since. In 2006, she started her own firm, where she focuses primarily on the practice of family law. Prior to law school, she spent 3 years as a DFCS caseworker, where she learned about the needs and dynamics of struggling families. As president of the Association of Women Law Students at Mercer, she founded the Women Law Students Annual Charity Gala and Auction. The event, with her help, has continued over the last 22 years and has now raised almost $300,000 for women's and children's charities in Middle Georgia. Connie serves as the chairperson of the Childhood Hunger Council for the Middle Georgia Community Food Bank, where more than 150,000 families in a 24-county area struggle to access nutritious and adequate amounts of food. Over the past 20-plus years, Connie and her husband have been actively involved in animal rescue in Middle Georgia. She has also been a regular supporter of Crisis Line and Safe House of Central Georgia for years, both financially and through pro bono representation of victims of domestic violence and sexual assault. Williford has also provided pro bono representation through the local office of the Georgia Legal Services Program, and more recently through the Middle Georgia Access to Justice Project, where she now serves on its executive committee. According to her nominator, Middle Georgia is a better place because Connie is a part of it. Ladies and gentlemen, we salute Connie L. Williford.
Congratulations, Judge Williford.
Wow, that light's bright. Thank you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, commission members, fellow recipients and staff, Chief Justice Benham and Mrs. Benham, and Chief Justice Melton. Thank you to the commission for recognizing me this evening. I'm most grateful to receive this most prestigious award. I'd like to thank Judge Bill Adams, who nominated me. As you heard earlier, Judge Adams is a former recipient and is an inspiration and role model for all who know him. Thank you to my wonderful family and friends, many who are here with me tonight and others who are viewing in live stream. They never ignore my calls, no matter how many times I ask and beg for their help or financial support for the charities that my husband and I support, and I couldn't do it without them. I'm humbled by the accomplishments of my fellow recipients. I'm sure you all feel as I do, privileged as I am to give back, because it really is a privilege. I'd like to dedicate this award to my late sister, Shannon Malloy, who is a pediatric oncology nurse, the true hero and servant in our family. And to my wonderful husband, my rock, I'm everything I am because you love me. Thank you.
Thank you, Joy. Our next honoree is Miss Jennifer Lee Weisenecker. And Jennifer does so many things. When we shot her video, she was an associate at Jones Day and since then has made partner. And having once many years ago worked at a bit firm, when I read her bio, it's like, how does she manage to get it all done? We're going to have to talk one day. But Jennifer founded a young people's group to support UNICEF, and we're going to learn more about that in the video. In addition, she's gone down to the border to take some cases, and so she has a lot of balls in the air. And let's learn a little bit more about Jennifer and all she does.
Thank you. Jennifer Lee Weisnecker is an associate in the Product Liability Defense Group in the Atlanta office of Jones Day. In addition to a professional position working multiple high-profile cases, Weisnecker has served as a dedicated volunteer for UNICEF, an organization that works in over 190 countries and territories to protect the rights of every child and to improve the lives of children and their families. She started first at UNICEF USA as the volunteer founder and chair of UNICEF Next Gen Atlanta. Starting with just a few friends in 2013, the group has now grown to over 80 members that raise over $150,000 annually for UNICEF. In 2016, UNICEF Next Gen Atlanta launched an annual fundraiser, the UNICEF Atlanta Art Party, which has raised almost $100,000 each year since its launch. Because of her leadership, the UNICEF USA Southeast Regional Board invited her to join the board in 2016, making her the youngest person to ever serve on the board. In addition to her work with UNICEF, Weisnecker provides pro bono legal services to asylum seekers. Working in difficult circumstances at the border, she has continued to show her dedication to the world's most vulnerable. In addition to her community service activities, Weisnecker teaches pre-law classes at Georgia Tech. She spoils her senior dog, Penny, and travels with her family and friends. Ladies and gentlemen, we salute Jennifer Lee Weisnecker.
Congratulations, Jennifer.
Thank you for this honor. It's humbling to receive an award inspired by Justice Benham and amongst this incredible group of honorees. With me here tonight are many people I'd like to thank that have all supported me continuously in my pro bono and UNICEF work. My fellow NextGen board members who have been with me from the beginning, helping to grow the organization. My colleagues at Jones Day, which has provided me numerous opportunities to do pro bono that I'm passionate about. And of course, my family, who's attended every UNICEF event that I've hosted that brings a level of enthusiasm that I think only parents can bring. UNICEF is an incredible organization who's worked for decades to give children an equitable chance at life. And it's a true privilege, you said it before me, it's a privilege to be in the position to even play just a small role in the work that UNICEF does for children. I look forward to continuing my service. Thank you again for this award.
Thank you, Jennifer. Our next honoree is Ms. Sally Yates, and I was very fortunate to work recently with Sally on a project that the Chief Justice's Commission on Professionalism did to raise awareness about suicide prevention. And in getting to know Sally through her bio, I found out that she is very heavily involved in this work, as well as some other things. I think one of the neatest things I learned was that while she was at the U.S. Attorney's Office, she started a program where she would go and read to children, I believe elementary school children, and encouraged others in her office to do the same. And the program, to my understanding, still continues today. And so while for many of us, Sally's name is a household name, there are many things that she does that people don't know about that we can all do to improve our communities. And that's the focus of this video. So let's take a look.
Sally Quillian Yates works as a partner on the Special Matters and Government Investigations team at King & Spalding. Previously, Yates was a 27-year veteran of the Department of Justice. She rose through the ranks of assistant United States attorneys to become U.S. Attorney for the Northern District of Georgia, the first woman to serve in that role. She later served as a United States Deputy Attorney General and as the Acting Attorney General. Yates' volunteerism is a powerful testament to the potential impact of community service. For 6 years, she mentored students as a high school mock trial coach at Thurl High School. One of the students she coached was Nakia Hackworth-Jones, who is now a partner at Nelson Mullins in Atlanta. Yates' mentorship of Jones did not end in high school. In 2015, while serving as Deputy Attorney General, she tapped Jones to work in the office of the Deputy Attorney General in Washington, D.C. as Senior Counsel and later as Associate Deputy Attorney General. Yates' volunteerism also transformed the way the DOJ engaged with communities it serves. During her tenure as the U.S. Attorney in Atlanta, she started a reentry program called New Beginnings. It became a model for other U.S. attorneys' offices that wanted to work with their local communities to address the root cause of crime and recidivism. She also tackled the beginning of the prison pipeline through the Everybody Wins Atlanta program by reading to elementary school students who were reading below grade level. Sally's volunteer activities are numerous. She co-chairs the Board of Trustees of the Council on Criminal Justice and serves on the Board of the Ethics and Compliance Initiative. In addition, she serves on the Board of Project Healthy Minds and volunteers to speak about issues related to criminal justice reform, mental health, and suicide prevention. Ladies and gentlemen, we salute Sally Quillian Yates.
Congratulations, Sally.
Justice Melton, Carlise, and of course, Justice Benham, I want to thank everyone here tonight connected with the Chief Justice's Commission on Professionalism for this truly meaningful award. I'm particularly honored to be recognized here tonight alongside my colleagues who have done such inspiring work over the course of their careers. And of course, we're all here tonight in homage to the living, breathing personification of community service in Justice Benham. You know, over the last 15 months, as too many of us have lost friends or colleagues or family members to COVID and felt that pain, but also been inspired by healthcare workers and others who have literally risked their lives to take care of strangers to them, but loved ones to us. And as we've seen and felt the swirl of hope and anguish as we take a long overdue step toward reconciliation for racial injustice that has gone on for centuries, I think we recognize that we really are tied together and Dr. King's single garment of destiny. And so thank you for what all of you do every single day to make that garment a little bit stronger and a little more beautiful. Thank you again for this recognition tonight.
Thank you. Our next honoree is Judge Robert Leonard. And Judge Robert Leonard and I are in the same family law in a court named after a previous Supreme Court Justice, Justice Walter. And so I would see him from time to time, say hello at our in a court meetings, but got to know him much better through our video. And I'm suspecting that Justice Benham's comments on helping serving on the board of individuals who had challenging disabilities probably resonated with Judge Leonard. It's just something that I did not know about him in our regular interactions. And so let's take a moment to look at the video and learn a little bit about how he has served his community.
Judge Robert D. Leonard II, a Kentucky native, has served the citizens of Cobb County since his appointment to the bench in December of 2010. Through his service on the benches of both the state and superior courts of Cobb County, he has the unusual honor of having been appointed by two different governors and elected three times without opposition. Judge Leonard has devoted a significant amount of his time and talents to community service. One of his primary volunteer commitments has been to serve as a passionate advocate for people with disabilities through his service on the Tommy Nobis Center Board of Directors. Since 1977, the center has served over 25,000 people and changed lives by championing workplace success for people with disabilities. Judge Leonard has been an instrumental part of the center's success, and he has served in various capacities, including board chair. There are days Judge Leonard could be found talking to younger children and high school students about the dangers of drugs, alcohol, and social media, or volunteering as a mentor for the Marietta Mentoring for Leadership program, or even coaching local sports. It has been said about him, many judges struggle with how to be engaged in the community while maintaining judicial independence. Judge Leonard is the exception. He does not struggle, he excels, and our world is a better place for it. Ladies and gentlemen, we salute the Honorable Robert D. Leonard II.
Congratulations, Judge Leonard.
So I had this great speech worked up, and I dropped it and lost it somewhere, and Sally must have picked it up because that's exactly what I was going to say. I'm just kidding. Carlise, I will remember that you put me after Sally. Nobody ever wants to have to go after her because she's such a rock star. I'm over here nerding out sitting next to her. But I want to thank my nominator, my CEO at the Tommy Nobis Center, the people who wrote in support of me, Judge Childs, and my former staff attorney, Melissa Bricky. Thank you to my family, my children, my wife, my parents. They're all here to share this night with me. It is an honor to be here with all of you. You think you're busy and you're doing great things until you come to something like this, and you're like, man, I could really do some more. And so this is a good thing. And Justice Benham, you've been such a role model for so many lawyers and a rock star in our bar for years. Your vision in creating this award, I think, has really elevated our profession, and it makes people think about lawyers in a different way. And so thank you for doing that. And Chief Justice Melton, it's always an honor to be anywhere with you, but I just want to take a minute. This is off topic and got nothing to do with these awards, but in your final week as the leader of our judiciary, I want to publicly thank you for your calm, level-headed, steady leadership through this pandemic. Our judiciary is better, our bar is better, the practice of law is better, and you've helped every person in this state, whether they know it or not. So thank you for your leadership, sir.
Thank you, Judge Leonard. And now we come to our next honoree, Judge Donarell Green. And when I read these bios, I, like Judge Leonard said, I think about, okay, what more can I do? I can read to children. I don't think I could do boxing, someone, you know, punching at me. But Judge Green does that and so much more. He, in the Athens community, and again, Judge Green was an attorney when he was nominated for the award, so you'll hear him in the video being referred to as an attorney, and has since been appointed to the Athens Clark County Magistrate Court as a judge, so congratulations to you. But he teaches boxing at the YMCA. He is a football coach. He hosts back-to-school drives for children and just does so much more to improve the community and to inspire the youth in Athens. And we need all the role models that we can get, no matter how old we get. I can attest to that. So let's take a look at the video for Judge Green. And
Donarell Ray Green IV was born in Albany, but raised in Athens, Georgia. Green comes from a family with strong ties to Athens and a prominent history of civic, educational, and professional service in Northeast Georgia. He began his legal career as a staff attorney with the Georgia Legal Services Program, but he later started his own private practice with his brothers, attorney Fredrell Ray Green and paralegal Gregory Green. Over the last 20 years, Green has practiced civil and criminal law in counties all over the state of Georgia. Donarell has a passion for sports and for working with youth, and his community service reflects those interests. Green, who is an avid boxer, has partnered with the Athens YMCA for over 12 years to train young people in the sport of boxing. The boxing education that Green has provided has helped these youth to engage in healthy activities and to learn discipline and respect. Green, who is a true believer that education is the key to success, has also frequently contributed to the Athens Tutorial Program and the Leaders as Readers Program. Several years ago, he spearheaded an effort to supply local youth with free book bags and school supplies. As his endorser wrote, he is always willing to help our young people meet their potential by working directly with them. Ladies and gentlemen, we salute Donarell Ray Green IV.
Congratulations, Judge.
The impact that can be made in a community by individuals in the legal profession, whether that be judges, lawyers, mediators, clerks of court, cannot be overstated. In general, our community looks to us for leadership. Our community looks up to us. And so when we participate in community service and we are hands-on, and we are looking in their eyes, and we are shaking their hands, and we are shoulder to shoulder with them in an effort to uplift our communities, it's incredible. And it's also incredible to the feeling that it gives you to be a participant in that process. I would like to thank Justice Melton. I would like to thank Chief Justice Benham, Carlos, for organizing this event. I'd also like to thank all the other organizers of this event. I believe that I owe the greatest thanks to Chief Justice Benham, who may not know it, but served me graciously my first fried fish plate as a lawyer in 1998, and it was delicious. Thank you for that. I would like to thank my family, my friends, my grandchildren. I would like to thank my community, all the legal professionals who have inspired me, who have served our community in such a wonderful way. I would like to thank my nominator, the Honorable Dexter Wimbish, Commissioner Ovita Thornton, and Jose Castro. And I would like to dedicate this award to my mother, the late Freddie Peters Green, who was my first elementary school teacher and also my first boxing instructor. I'm honored, I'm privileged to be receiving this award with such a distinguished group, and I'm inspired to go back home and do more. Thank you.
Thank you, Judge Cole. Next, we come to our Lifetime Achievement Awards, and It is such an honor to be able to pay tribute to two wonderful individuals. The first is Tommy Malone. And Tommy Malone's name was a name that I had often heard, but again, as I put together bios and learned more about the individuals, I learned so much more about Mr. Malone and all he did for his community to help bring fairness and equality to his community, and then to go forward and endow scholarships for law students to teach young people about the dangers of texting and driving, drinking and driving, diving headfirst into pools, just taking the time to give back and to pour into the community. And it is wonderful to be able to honor him tonight posthumously and to present his award to his son, Mr. Adam Malone. But let's take a moment to learn a little bit more about Tommy Malone's impact on our community.
The late Thomas William Malone Sr. was born and raised in the South Georgia city of Albany. He was admitted to the Georgia Bar in 1965 before he graduated from law school. But in 1966, he graduated from the Mercer University Walter F. George School of Law. He passed on October 1st, 2019 at the age of 76 after a long and courageous battle with cancer. For more than 50 years, Malone, the founder of Malone Law, successfully litigated cases involving catastrophic personal injury and wrongful death throughout the state of Georgia. One of the things he often discussed were the cases he lost in his early years, representing mostly African American or poor white people against Albany's power elite. After many losses in court cases, in 1984, after practicing law for almost 19 years, Malone won the second ever $1 million verdict in Georgia. He went on to obtain a multitude of jury verdicts in excess of $1 million. One of his record-setting $45 million verdicts changed the way managed care providers operate. But he never focused on making money, just about making a difference in people's lives. Malone established several scholarships during his lifetime, including the Rosser Malone Endowed Scholarship in honor of his father to Mercer Law students, and the Patrona Underwood Malone Scholarship Fund at Shorter College, which was set up in honor of his mother. Since 2002, he supported the Shepherd Spine Center, now known as the Shepherd Center, and its foundation, on whose board of trustees he served for many years. He was also a longtime supporter of Mercer University and served as a member of the university's Board of Trustees. Malone also served on the Carter Center Board of Counselors, a leadership advisory group that works to advance understanding of and support for the Carter Center. Another beneficiary of his philanthropy was the Just Beginning Foundation, a pipeline organization with the aim of improving the representation of minorities in the profession. When once asked, "What is your motto?" he responded, "That there is no greater reward than being able to make a meaningful difference in the quality of life of another person." Ladies and gentlemen, we salute our Lifetime Achievement Award honoree, Thomas William Malone Sr.
That made me so proud to see that video. Thank you, Carlise, Chief Justice Benham, Chief Justice Melton, and to all who thought so much of my father to honor him in this way. I'm a little moved by that video. Well, let me say this. I wish I had that velvety baritone voice of whoever it is doing those videos, because I feel like if I could speak that way, I could just stand up in front of the jury and say, "I think I should win," and I would win.
He's right back there. I'll introduce you.
As I was reflecting last night on what I thought my dad would say in accepting this award, I knew his love, respect, and admiration for you, Chief Justice Benham, and among many honors and accolades that I know he received over the course of his 50-year career, this one he would have been most proud. I'm most certain of that. But something told me to go back and pull out the literally hundreds of letters and notes and emails that I received after he passed away on October 1st, 2019. And I'm so glad I did that, because I was moved all over again, and I was struck not by the sheer number of most heartfelt, sincere condolences that were sent to me, but by those who sent them. Of course, there were lawyers from all over the country, and there were judges, but one of the things that stood out to me the most was a great number of those notes were sent by his adversaries. I hope that when I finish my career, my adversaries think as much of me as they did of him. And you know, there were bailiffs, there were courthouse personnel, there were judicial law clerks who wrote those notes as well. There were electricians, there were plumbers, there were carpenters, and of course, if you knew my dad, there were fishermen who also wrote some of those letters. I want to say about community service, he would often quote, and he was not a religious man, but he knew what Paul said to the Ephesians in chapter 4, verse 1, where he commanded the Ephesians to be worthy of the calling they had received. And my dad lived a worthy life in pursuit of this noble calling. And one day we were sitting in the office and we were talking about how year after year there are these forces that seem to meet and want to close the courthouse doors to the people that we represent with legislation and other movements. And we said, you know what, they may one day succeed. We'll never stop fighting to prevent that. But why don't we see if we can prevent these preventable disasters that harm the people we represent before they ever even occur? And so we reached out to the medical director of the Shepherd Brain and Spinal Center, Dr. Don Leslie, and that started the involvement that you saw on the video of his service and our creation, along with Shepherd Center, of the Injury Prevention Project, which is still thriving today to try and prevent these disasters that unfortunately we only meet the families of the survivors after it already happens, before these things happen. So let me say this in closing, because this is what I think that a message that he would want to leave all of you with if he were here and able to say it himself. Because he ingrained into me, Adam, your essential quest in every working hour of your professional life is a quest for justice and fairness. But he would say, remember, as lawyers, we are not merchants in a marketplace concealing flaws, cutting quality, inflating prices to enhance the bottom line of personal profit. We are not in commerce, dealing and bargaining over merchandise. We have chosen instead to follow a professional calling, concerned with the most precious of all human values, the rights of individual people. He would say, as lawyers, we should remember this. We may live a life worthy of our calling and honor our duty to professionalism by prioritizing our duties in this way. First, our duty is to humanity. Second, our duty is to the court. Third, our duty is to our client. And at the very last, our duty is to our own self-interest. So on behalf of my dad's beloved wife, our stepmother, Haley, his beautiful grandchildren, Maddie, Emily, and Rosser, and Kennedy Carter, who couldn't be here, my brother and myself, we want to say thank you Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Adam. Our final honoree this evening, last but certainly not least, is Miss Jackie Payne. And as a disclaimer, I play no role in selecting who gets the awards, but I was personally very thrilled when I learned that Jackie Payne was one of the recipients this year, because she has been a longtime mentor of mine through work that I did with the Atlanta Legal Aid Society Fulton Family Law Information Center. And Jackie was my supervisor and poured into me from a legal standpoint, held my hand and helped me through one of the most terrible times of my life when my mother passed. And then when I read her bio, it's like, what? She's doing all this other stuff that I had no idea about. And I've said that before, but I say it because we work alongside people. We admire and respect them as professionals, but we have no idea of the tremendous impact that they have on the community, including founding a nonprofit. I had no idea. So let's learn a little bit more about Jackie Payne and the wonderful work that she does on top of working and mentoring lawyers at Atlanta Legal Aid Society.
Jacqueline L. Jackie Payne has spent almost all of her 38-year legal career as a lawyer for the Atlanta Legal Aid Society, where she has devoted her time and talents to helping low-income, vulnerable, and often minority families, and to protecting victims of domestic violence. Payne often uses her experiences at Atlanta Legal Aid, both legal and social, as she volunteers with and leads other community organizations that seek to benefit the same population. She serves on the ISDD Innovative Solutions for Disadvantage and Disability Board of Directors as ISDD's Board Vice Chair, a 501c3 nonprofit organization founded in 2004. It assists children with disabilities being raised in kinship families, primarily grandparents, in parent absent homes, and children who have experienced homelessness. Payne is also a founding member of 10 Women of Hope, which was formed in 2007. And provides one-time financial support to stable single-parent families in Cobb County who are experiencing a critical need. Over the past 10 years, she has served as a member of the Marietta Schools Foundation Board of Directors, supporting the mission of the Marietta School System of providing educational excellence and achievement for the students, faculty, staff, and administrators. Payne's volunteer service also extends to her faith community. She's been an active member of the Episcopal Church of the Incarnation in Atlanta for over 30 years, contributing as a teacher and mentor to the church's middle school youth, substitute Sunday school teacher, member of the choir, and as a team leader for the church's altar guild. Jacqueline also volunteers her legal talents at community events. In her day job as an attorney for Atlanta Legal Aid, Payne has also made a lasting impact. She helped create the Kinship Care Project, which she now manages, assisting grandparents and other relatives adopt children they are raising. And the list goes on and on. Her nominators all agree that Jacqueline has been an example and role model to and for how a lawyer with a servant's heart should meaningfully contribute to improving our community. Ladies and gentlemen, we salute our Lifetime Achievement Award honoree, Miss Jacqueline L. Jackie Payne.
Congratulations, Jackie. I still don't know how you found time to mentor baby lawyers like me.
Good afternoon, everyone. I was so humbled and surprised when I received a call to indicate that I'd been chosen for a Lifetime Achievement Award for community service. I thought, well, okay. I've been practicing law for almost 40 years, so I guess that gets me to Lifetime Achievement. But, you know, I have to thank all of the people who have helped me to be able to do the community service work that I have done and that I continue to do. I want to thank, first of all, the Executive Director of Atlanta Legal Aid, Steve Gottlieb, who nominated me for this and has been both my mentor and leader during the 40 years that I've practiced law. I thank him for giving me the time and the opportunity to be able to serve the community, not just in the everyday work that I do with legal aid, but with all of the other activities. Growing up in Atlanta, I attended a small faith-based private school where we had daily devotion. And one of the songs that stuck in my head from that time had a chorus about brighten the corner where you are. And I think I took that on as my goal in life, to always do something that would be helpful to others, do something that would brighten their lives and make them better in the process. I never thought I would be a lawyer, not something I thought about, not something I envisioned, but being someone full of faith, I think God led me to the career that I've been able to have. And I feel that in everything that I have done, I've been led in that way. So to be able to work with kinship families, to help victims of domestic violence, to help senior citizens resolve their legal issues, to volunteer to do back-to-school packs for kids who wouldn't have supplies, to buy Christmas gifts and deliver them. You know, those things, they are small things, but those small things mean a lot to the families that are involved with that. And I want to thank my family for always being there for me, for supporting me, for oftentimes joining in to help on some of these projects that I've done over the years. My three daughters, my brothers, my grandsons, my dad who passed away 2 years ago, my mom who wasn't able to be here tonight because of physical infirmities, but whom I hope is watching on YouTube with one of my brothers. Every day, I'm thankful for the work that I can do and that I continue to do. Every day, I'm thankful for the opportunity to be able to do those things. Every day, I'm thankful for the opportunity to brighten that corner where I am, that community where I live, the places that I serve, and the people that I serve. Thank you all again.
Thank you, Jackie. And so, as we get ready to wind down, I want to take a moment to thank everyone who helped put this program together. First and foremost, I have to thank the chair of the commission, Chief Justice Harold D. Melton, and my boss for a few more days, and Justice Benham. I hope I don't get in trouble for saying this, but I want to thank you for so publicly stating and promoting the fact that you are both fully vaccinated, because I would not have had the courage to go forward with an in-person event unless you were, because my biggest fear is something is going to happen to Justice Benham or Justice Melton if we gather in person. But then, you know, they went out there and said we're fully vaccinated, so it's like, okay, let's try it. So I thank you both for your leadership and for being here this evening. As you can see, this is a very special occasion for so many people, and it honors and acknowledges such great work that has tremendous impact on our community. I also want to thank all of the folks in 2020 who had so graciously volunteered their time and their talents. They are listed in the program, and the program will be made available on YouTube. So look for it, and you can read more about our honorees and learn more about the Benham Awards. But we had a lot of people who had pledged to volunteer time last year, much of it before the awards, because there is a lot that goes into creating this award ceremony before the event actually happens. And so they are acknowledged in the program, and I do want to take a moment to thank them. They are too numerous to name. But I also want to thank our commission members, Justice Melton, Justice Benham, Justice Sarah Hawkins Warren, who gave leadership and advice to the commission in 2020, and we are now getting that from our newest advisor from the Supreme Court, Justice Sean Ellen LaGruis. I want to thank them, as well as all of our commission members, advisors, and liaisons. I want to thank the staff, people who greeted you at the reception table, and Ms. Melissa Hurd, Ms. Ashley Lewis, a recent graduate of Atlanta's John Marshall Law School, and Mr. Nicholas Williams, who is here tonight. I want to thank them all for helping to do everything, and for all of our vendors who are helping with the live stream, the AV. We could not have done this without all of you. And so if you'd take a, let's take a moment to give them a round of applause. And Chief Justice Melton so graciously thanked our sponsors earlier, but I would be remiss if I did not also take a moment to say thank you to all our sponsors. I won't call their names again, but I do want to acknowledge that we could not literally have done this program without their support, and so thank you. And I just want to circle back for one moment to Chief Justice Melton. We also have a token for you up here as well on your retirement. You also have been a mentor and a leader. And when I think about the sermon you watch versus the sermon that you hear, Chief Justice Melton comes to mind in terms of helping me to grow in professionalism and to learn about professionalism. Just watching how he has managed this horrific crisis that no one could have foreseen or thought about. You know, his fearlessness in letting the commission tackle some difficult issues around race and social justice and suicide prevention. None of that would happen without his leadership, and he's always so quiet and so calm, and regardless of what is thrown at him, he just makes it all seem easy. And none of this would happen without his leadership. You know, if Chief Justice Melton says, no, we can't have a Benham Award ceremony, none of you would be here. And so I am going to miss our chair, a mentor and a friend, and I just would like for all of us to take a moment to acknowledge his leadership as he gets ready to retire after 16 years on the court and 3 years as the chair of the Chief Justice's Commission on Professionalism. Can we all just give him a round of applause? And with that, Chief Justice, I would ask that you come up and make our closing remarks and just say thank you again for allowing us to have this wonderful evening and for your leadership during this past year.
We're both fully back today.
Well, thank you, Carlise, for those fine words. Justice Benham is 20 years older than me to the day. He retired after 30 years on the bench. I'm leaving after 30 years in state government. He absolutely set the standard by which I had to aspire towards. These people, these award winners, these honorees have set the standard by which we all will aspire towards going forward. Thank you for the example you have set. Thank you for showing us practical ways that we can encourage and get involved in making a difference in our communities. Congratulations and thank you for your continued service, and may we all do likewise. Go and have a good night. Thank you very much.
I just want to remind our attorneys in the audience that the commission, our videographer who created all of the wonderful videos you see here, Vince Bailey, is outside to the right, ready to capture you in talking about what professionalism means to you and why it's important. So for our attorneys, please take a moment to stop by and film those, since we have attorneys from all over the state here tonight, for possible inclusion on our social media. Thank you, good night, and enjoy, everyone.